history of temples, and here is a point dedicated to the temples of Bhubaneswar. The poor have their gods, the rich too have theirs. But the temples of Bhubaneswar have gods of a different kind. Neither poor nor rich, simply terracotta, stone, or a flag of flower. You can see in pestilence, cloven hooves making their way into a forest's door, into an iconic volcano's interior, shaded grey with fever, or into a needle sign etched on the cave walls of a lore. Odias are good people. Odias are nice people. They speak English when angry, Hindi when cornered, and break into Sanskrit when exasperated. But with their million gods, they are forever tongue-tied, only a bit irreverent, when their prayers die with parakeets in paddy fields for want of water. They speak to their gods in sleep, and offer what they couldn't to their petulant wives: diamond diadems, silver anklets, and tongues of gold. But the gods know temptations offered by the poor in any case is better than the real stuff offered by the rich, the famous, and the dead. Temples of Bhubaneswar are full of red-assed baboons, blind bats, and tittering stones. Apart from the presiding god, the courier gods, and the courtier gods, and the no-nonsense copulating pairs. And yes, there are trees too. Trees in these temples flaunting a confetti of a rage wish around the year. The gods in the temples of Bhubaneswar blink when the American tourist clicks his camera and clucks his tongue, and the honeycombed crevices spewing rainwater, bare arms of celestial nymphs, goose pimpled by bird shit, encircled rear pillars of smoke, rising from the sacrificial fire, lighted on little sandbed like a pyre. Gods and goddesses sleep, gods and goddesses sleep, when mighty winds build up in the sea, and dark clouds gather, their roots of lightning spreading contagion into the germinal hour. These are gods, not rich gods. They say, these are not poor gods either. Look at their frayed shoes. Look at their noses of silver. Frayed shoes and noses of silver. These are gods of another kind in the temples of Bhubaneswar, whose trade after crops failed in heaven and remained here since as sculptures on the river bank of hunger. Yes, their shoes are frayed from too much walking up and down the divine corridor. Yes, their noses are flashy silver from too much rubbing of recognition with fear. These are different gods, awakened from the repose of scriptures by tiny grasshoppers at the wee hours, and unleashed in pairs to fill home spaces and voids between the meal hour. Odias are good people, but their gods, particularly those in the temples of Bhubaneswar, are even better. They listen to prayer only in Sanskrit, and all things that are there in the sculpture and in the scripture. They like half-light where alphabets blur. Food of flood after famine is after all a routine affair, they say. And other things being equal, these damned calamities, they think, are perfectly in order, normal and natural for the Odias to bear.